thank you for being a guest here at calmclass.com. This website is dedicated to one thing, to be able to give you a different mindset. To be able to stay calm in tough times is by changing how you think, because when you change how you think, it changes how you live. My name is Dwight Bain. I'll be your host through most of these lessons, but I'm really glad that you found us. I'm really glad that you're taking time out to watch a lesson that will be life-changing. So do this. Take good notes. Download the study guides. Let these life application principles make your life a better place. And then would you let us know how this is helping you? My thanks to you for watching. My thanks to our incredible team for making it happen. But most of all, my thanks to God, because He gives us principles that will change our life if we use them. Are you ready? Let's get started.
So I'm sitting there on this beautiful July morning, and the Bible teacher who had presented the morning message was out walking around the lake. He saw me and came over. His name was Dr. Lehman Strauss. Long time, he was an older man even then, long time Bible teacher, itinerant evangelist, and a great sports fan. So he sat down, we talked a little bit, and then he did something that nobody has ever done since. He turned to me and said, "How are you doing in your own personal study of the Word of God?" Have you ever been asked that question?
No.
I've been a Christian about 7 years, and had my ups and downs. I'd floundered a little bit, and but I did have the presence of mind that morning to say to him, "Dr. Strauss, not very well, but what do you suggest?" He seemed to like that. And here's what he said to me. He said, "There are many ways to study the Scriptures." He said, "But I'm going to share with you one way that I have found particularly effective." He said, "What I'd like you to do, because this is the 1st of July, is to forget 65 books of the Bible. And I want you to concentrate on one book, the book of James. And here's what I want you to do." He said, "I want you to read it through every day for the entire month of July. Read it once a day, every day, for the entire month of July." That means 31 times. He said, "You could do that in about 15 to 18 minutes a day." He said, "You can use different translations. But at the end of July, you'll have read it 31 straight times." And he predicted that you will feel as if the book of James is yours. He then went on to say, "On the 1st of August, you can move on to another book. I would recommend Philippians." And he said, "In the month of August, do the same." He said, "In fact, you've got about a year that you can work through smaller books of the Bible that you can handle in 15 to 18 minutes a day." He said, "You'll find them. There are about 12 of them." He said, "However, when you get to the bigger books, well, you're going to have to break them down and do it a different way." He said, "But don't worry about that." He said, "For 1 year, you're in good shape." So he said, "Let's get started on the book of James." Well, I did. And that month of July, 1975, I read the book of James once a day, every day. And at the end of the month, guess what happened? I felt that the book of James was mine, that I owned it, that every inch of the book was my personal book. And to this day, whenever James comes up in a sermon, or he pops up in some written devotional perhaps, Our Daily Bread, for example, all I can do is think back to the month of July, 1975, and that day when Dr. Strauss shared with me what he thought was a pretty good way to get into the Bible, and there's James. I'll tell you what also hit me that time. I started to memorize the early verses of chapter 1. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into adverse temptations. That's how the book opens.
Yeah.
And down a few verses, verse 5, I believe, we run into this, and this one really hit me right in the forehead. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally, that means in abundance, and upbraideth not, that means he doesn't scold you. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not. On Friday before the Magic game, the team chaplain asked me to speak to the players of the two teams at the chapel service, and I did. And then our team went out and got whipped by 15 points or so. I may just have to retire from that little duty. But I spoke to the players who were there that night on Friday, and I said, here's the deal. No matter what circumstances you are in, you get to ask for wisdom on the spot. I mean, and you don't have to kneel down or come up with anything flowery. I said, in a game situation or a situation with your coach, situation with a referee, situation off the court, perhaps with family, finances, I said, there are things coming at you every day where you need wisdom. And according to James chapter 1, verse 5, we can come to God as many times as we need. Lord, I need wisdom. And he's going to give it to us in abundance. It's pretty awesome, isn't it?
Amen.
And he's never going to scold us. So I told the players on Friday night, I said, that means if you come to him for wisdom at 10 o'clock in the morning, and you're right back at noon with another request, and then at 3 o'clock you need more wisdom, and then during the game that night, there are at least five situations where you need wisdom, God is never going to say, that's enough. I'm tired of hearing from you. I got bigger issues in the Middle East. You know, we've got the economy of China. I mean, I got all this stuff hanging, and here you are knocking, I mean, repeatedly today, 12 times you've come asking for wisdom. And God is never going to get upset about that or nail you or scold you or cause you grief. He enjoys hearing from our requests for wisdom. Can I ask a very personal question? How many of you feel that you possess wisdom?
Very little wisdom.
How many of you feel that you are a wise person? I mean, wisdom seems to be a big deal with God. It comes up a good bit in the Bible. What does David Jeremiah have to say in his study Bible, which I am now carrying around like Charles Stanley? You know, it has that big floppy Bible. That,
yeah.
It's good to have a floppy Bible. So let's take a look here at what David Jeremiah says. Those with wisdom know what to do in the midst of confusing circumstances. Those with wisdom know what to do in the midst of confusing circumstances. A clarity that only God can give. But one that he will provide without reproach if his children only ask. Liberally means stretching out. Picture a beautiful banquet table arrayed with all the delicious morsels of wisdom that God has made available to believers. That is how generous God is toward his children. How many of you know or have had people in your life who possessed wisdom? That's good. Was it one, two? Rare quality, would you say? People that you could go to when there were circumstances in your life that were confusing and it was muddled and not clear, and there was somebody you could go to. Let me tell you about my introduction to wisdom. I was 24 years old. Working for the Philadelphia Phillies, I had played 2 years of minor league baseball, and the Phillies had seen enough. They said I was in the twilight of a very mediocre playing career. The only claim to fame I ever had as a professional baseball player was in Miami my first year, 1962. I was a catcher, backup catcher, and we had a young pitcher, 18 years old. His name was Ferguson Jenkins. You've heard of him now. I mean, he's in the Baseball Hall of Fame. Well, there he was, 18 years old, and it seemed that every time it was his turn to pitch, I would get to catch. In fact, we saw Fergie in the hotel lobby in Toronto at the All-Star game a couple of weeks ago. He's Canadian. Had a nice visit with him, and he introduced me. Oh, Pat Williams, my first catcher in baseball. So this one night, I think he lost one game that summer, and I was behind the plate. It was a rather typical evening for me. There were four or five stolen bases, five or six pass balls. It was quite a night for me. After the game, a writer from the Miami Herald went up to Fergie and said, "Fergie, by the way, who is the toughest man for you to pitch to in the Florida State League?" And Fergie said, "My catcher, Williams." At that point, the Phillies suggested that I had a better chance behind the desk than behind the plate. And I ended up at age 24 going to Spartanburg, South Carolina, which was a minor league club of the Phillies, a farm club. They needed a new GM, and I was now an executive. And so, 24 years old, the Phillies in Philadelphia said, "When you get to Spartanburg, here's the address of the owner of the team. His name is Little John, Mr. R.E. Little John. They said, go introduce yourself and get started. Here's his address." So I arrived in Spartanburg on a cold, dreary Sunday in February of 1965, scared to death, just scared to death. I knocked on the door of the house, and a woman came. It was Mrs. Little John, and we had a nice little chat. She explained to me that her husband was away that day and would be in his office on Monday. And then, just before she closed the door and I left, she said, "No matter how long you're in ball," that's what she called baseball, "no matter how long you're in ball, you'll never meet another man like my husband." I had never heard up to that point a wife say that about her husband. And I must tell you, I have not heard it said since. But that's what she said to me. As it turns out, it was a correct evaluation. I spent 4 years in Spartanburg as the general manager of the farm club there before I left and got into pro basketball. Spent 4 years, and 4 years with Mr. Littlejohn. I used to kid him by saying, "You know, I got my undergrad degree at Wake Forest and my master's degree at Indiana, and I'm getting my doctorate here at Little John Tech." Mr. Little John had a rare quality called wisdom. He was a godly man, a deacon at the First Baptist Church of Spartanburg. But it was amazing to me, people from all over that area would come to him, come to his house, to talk. I was not aware really of what it was about, but all I knew was that the basketball coach at Furman University might be there, or the newly hired pastor at First Baptist Orlando would be at his house, the president of one of the local banks would be there, or Ed Young Sr., then a very young pastor in that area of South Carolina, who now pastors the Second Baptist Church of Houston. He would come to spend time at Mr. Littlejohn's house. And me. I mean, I would be over there all the time with situations that had come up, and I would have my list, and we would go over them. And I wondered through that period, what in the world were all these people doing coming to 2138 Glendalen Place in Spartanburg, South Carolina, to spend time with his math? Well, as we read in David Jeremiah's interpretation of that little piece, things were muddled for these people. Things were going on that were not clear. They realized they had to do something about it, and they would come to Mr. Littlejohn, who would hear them out, and then come up with some kind of a working solution, you know, as he listened to all this, and then had the ability through wisdom that God had given him to plow through the fog for these people. And when they would leave, they were bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, because they now had a different look, a different picture of how they're going to go about things. So as the 4 years there running the Phillies club with under Mr. Littlejohn's ownership, when things came up, and boy did they come up, and I would go to Mr. Littlejohn in a muddled state and listen as he began to work his way through and get it clarified for me, I took notes. I mean, I began to write down things, you know, as they were unfolding during those early years of my career. And eventually, I wrote two books about Mr. Littlejohn and his wisdom principles. I'm going to share with you this morning the six principles of wisdom that he passed on to me that seemed to come up the most frequently in my 6 years there. Wisdom principles that Mr. Littlejohn had gained. He was not formally educated. He spent some time as a freshman at Furman University in Greenville, South Carolina, but had to drop out and never had a formal education. But he had this wonderful quality called wisdom. And when we finish today, boy, I think we need to individually plead and shout out to God and ask him repeatedly, Lord, I need wisdom. And please provide it now, because I've got a situation that needs rectifying. Here are Mr. Littlejohn's six wisdom principles that I learned as a young baseball executive in my mid-20s and have carried with me because I'm now in my mid-70s. And so that means 50 years ago they came up. And I'm grateful, because I was not really a Christian at that point. I was a churchgoer, but I didn't really know the Lord. But I'm so pleased that I had the presence of mind to write them down. All right, are you ready? Everybody got paper?
They're ready.
And we've got writing instruments. Do we have a pen or a pencil? Wisdom principle number one. Control those things over which you have control, and let go of everything else. Do we have any control freaks in here?
I'm a recovering control freak.
We've got a lot of control freaks, and it looks like a lot of liars. I mean, I'm...
I'll have to raise my hand for that.
Yeah, that was good. Now, you came right out. What is it, Eloise?
A dear member in this class said she resigns as CEO of the universe.
That was
me. She told me that, and I'm like, that's a good one. I like that.
Yeah.
Because that's what we need to do.
Control those things over which you have control and let go of everything else. Now, when you're running a minor league baseball team, certainly in those days, it was a one-man shop. The two things that were the most important in that situation in sports, number one, good players, and players that are doing well for you, that you don't want the big team in Philadelphia to move them to another team, you know, in the middle of the season because they're playing extremely well. That's issue number one. Issue number two is the weather. You can spend all winter pulling together your outstanding promotions and your big attractions and everything. And then a thunderstorm booms up about 3 o'clock in the afternoon and destroys the field, and the entire promotion is shot. So I spent most of my time worrying about what the Phillies were doing with our team and the whole weather situation. Every day there was a home game. Mr. Littlejohn saw that, and I think he was concerned that I was wearing out my stomach lining, that I was absolutely going to destroy my health. And one day he sat me down and he said, "Pat," in his wonderful South Carolina drawl, "tell me, how much control do you really think you have with Philadelphia and these players? You know, about who they keep and who they release and who they promote, who they take from us because they're playing so well. Tell me, do you have any control over that? The Phillies pay their salaries, and they've signed them, and they're all their players. Do you have any control over what the big club does with our players here?" And to a young hotshot baseball executive to say, none, zero, that was hard for me to do. But he said, let's just back off here. Oh, and about the weather, he said, "Do you really think these dances you do and the waving of towels towards the black clouds? Because the players are waving the clouds this way. They want a night off. And you want to get the gate in, and you're waving the clouds that way." He said, "Do you think that has any control over what the weather's going to be like this particular night?" Oh, I had to admit, none. Then he said, "How much control do you have over how clean your ballpark is?" I said, "A lot." "And how tasty the concessions are?" "Yeah, I think we can control that." "And how attractive the ladies' room is here at the ballpark?" "Oh," I said, "we've got a very attractive ladies' room. We need to keep it up." He said, "Well, let's just focus on that." He said, "Why don't you just stay absolutely locked in on what you can control, and let's let go the rest of it so that you don't ruin your health and you're in the hospital here by the end of the season." I said, "Okay, let's give that a shot." Now, I wish I could tell you I had it perfected in the first week. 50 years later, I'm still working on it. But I've come a long way. I'm a whole lot better than I was at age 25 at beautiful Duncan Park in Spartanburg. Control. Those things over which you have control, and let go of everything else. Wisdom principle number two. Be patient. Oh, I can still hear Mr. Littlejohn. "Be patient, Pat. Be patient." And I was the most impatient young man you have ever seen in your life. I wanted everything done at once. And I wanted it done correctly, and I didn't want there to be any foul-ups. And, oh, boy, patience was not part of my life. And and then I learned a lesson. My first year, it was in the spring. We had a game that night with Thomasville in North Carolina. About a 3-hour drive from Thomasville in a bus down to Spartanburg. And the general manager in Thomasville, because the weather was shaky that day, he kept calling me and saying, "We really don't want to make a 3-hour trip if the game's going to be rained out. What can you tell me?" And he kept calling. And finally I gave in, because it was probably about midday. And I said, "It's wet here, it's raining, you know, don't even come." Well, guess what happened? At about 2 o'clock, and I was rooting for the rain, at 2 o'clock, the rain and the sun came out, and a nice wind along with it. And by 5 o'clock, the field was just perfect. And Mr. Littlejohn had some visitors in town, and they were going to come and enjoy a night at the ballpark. So he arrived at the park about 6, and I said, "Mr. Little John, there's no game tonight." And he's standing on this perfectly dry field with a beautiful sun, and, well, what happened? And I told him what happened. And the next day he called me in to have a little chat. And the chat was about patience. He said, "Your job is to get the games in. I mean, really, at any cost. And you'd have been much better off having them drive down on the bus and come on down and then sending him home if the rain just continued, rather than having them not even anywhere in sight and we lose a gate." He said, "Patience, Pat, patience. If you'd just been a little more patient, you know, that would have just worked in your favor." I still hear his voice. He talks to me from time to time when I get antsy and flighty. Just be patient, be patient. And he was very patient. I mean, I think as a Christian, he was a godly man, and I admired that. I once said to him, I said, "You have to be the man most like Jesus in the world." Well, he was kind of overwhelmed with that, but he had Christ-like qualities. And I've noticed this with strong Christians. Boy, they're really patient. They don't get all out of sorts, and they know that God's timing is perfect. And they know that at the right time, God is going to act or move. And those kind of men and women just have a great strength of character, because they wait for God's perfect timing. Here's the third wisdom principle I could share with you. You've got to have experience, Pat. You've got to have experience. So our first season ended. We didn't have a very good team, but we drew well and we got some national attention. It was a good year, you know, from that standpoint. And I remember after the last game, sitting in Mr. Little John's car, basically saying goodbye to him. That we had this good year, and I was now 25 years old, and it was just going to be a matter of days till the Yankees called, or the Cardinals, or the Phillies. To hire me and bring my magic, you know, to their city, to the big city. Just a matter of days. Fortunately, Mr. Little John did not laugh at me. He could have, but he didn't. And he gave me a little chat about the importance of experience. He said, "Pat, you're not ready yet. So much more you need to learn. So many more experiences you need to gather." He said, "So let's keep your sights right here." And he said, "Now the question is, can you come back next year and better what you did this year?" He made an interesting statement. He said, "There are a whole lot of one-shot salespeople out there. Oh, they can go in and sell up a storm one time. But when they go back the second time, nobody wants to do business with them." He said, "You've got to prove that you're more than a one-shot salesman to this community." That would include selling wall signs and program ads and promotional nights and all that. I mean, that goes into running a ball club. And he made it very clear. He said, "Got to have experience. You got to pay your dues. You got to learn this business." And then he made an unbelievable statement to me. He said, "You can go to the big leagues from Spartanburg." He said, "You can go to the major leagues from Spartanburg." Now, Spartanburg was at the lowest level of minor league ball. And there would be about, you know, from A to high A to double A to triple A and then the big leagues. And that was the sense, whether you're a player or a manager or an umpire or whatever, you've got to work your way up to different levels, and then the big leagues is the ultimate level. He is saying to me that night, "You can go from here to the big leagues. This level of baseball to the big leagues." But the message was, you got to have experience. You've got to learn this business from the ground up. Footnote. I came back in 1966. We had an even better year. 1967, very good year. 1968, another good year. I was now 28 years old. And that winter, I'd come to the Lord. I'd made a decision to accept Christ and be a Christ follower. So that was a whole other dimension to my life. So in July of 1968, I walked into my office one day at the ballpark. There was a little pink slip. They're long gone. Those are the pink telephone slips. We don't see them anymore. But I got one, and it was to return a phone call to a Jack Ramsey in Inglewood, California. And I looked at that. I said, I know that name. Longtime coach at St. Joe's in Philadelphia, the general manager of the 76ers. Ingle, what in the world would he be calling me? So I returned the call, and sure enough, it was Dr. Jack Ramsey. He explained he was in Inglewood, California, trading Wilt Chamberlain to the Lakers in a big deal. And Jack informed me that he was going to end up coaching the team as well, in addition to being the GM. And he needed somebody to run the front office because he was going to be a full-time coach. And he asked me, would you be interested?
Wow.
Now, I never met him, and he never met me. I was 28 years old, and I flew twice to Philadelphia for a series of interviews. They offered me the job as the business manager to run the ball club in Philadelphia. 3-year contract, Alicia. $20,000 a year. I felt I was...
What year?
This would be 1968. I mean, I felt like the richest man in Babylon. And I left and went to Philadelphia, and gosh, that was almost 40 years ago, you know, in that profession. But remember what Mr. Littlejohn said? He said, you can go to the big leagues from Spartanburg. Nobody else had ever done that, but he told me that as a 25-year-old. But his message was experience. You got to have experience. Let me move to the fourth wisdom principle of Mr. Littlejohn. A godly man who had wisdom. Keep it simple. Keep it simple. Life is not complicated. And... He had a sense of humor. One day he was talking to me, and he said, now listen, he said, I'm just a country boy from down here. He said, you would drive around in a red Toronado. Remember Toronados? Oh, boy. Well, he helped me get the car, but he said, you've got this fancy red Toronado, and you've got a degree from here and a degree from there. And then he reminded me that life is not complicated. He said, and keep it as simple as you can. He said, particularly in the way you talk to people or in the way you communicate. He liked that word, communicate. And recently I read a quote from General Colin Powell. Here's what he said. He said, great leaders are great simplifiers. And Mr. Littlejohn could do that. He could sit in a meeting, you know, a board meeting at the church or at the bank, you know, at the university. He could sit in those board meetings, and he would not say anything. He would always be the last one. Everybody would be doing their, at the meeting, and he would just sit there. Everybody in the room knew he would be the last one to speak. And what he was going to say is what was going to happen. But he would listen. And then sort through all the different issues that he had heard and then come up with just a very simple solution or conclusion or suggestion. And the people would think, God, why didn't we think of that? You know, we spent 3 hours here. Why didn't we think of that? Life is not complicated. Keep it simple. Now, let me talk to you about the fifth wisdom principle that Mr. Littlejohn had. Don't run from your problems, Pat. They give you a wonderful chance to sell yourself to others. Now, in those days, running a minor league baseball team, oh my goodness, we were one problem away from the next problem. I mean, on any given day, here's what could happen. The Phillies just took our best hitter and moved him to a higher classification. And the ladies' room got stopped up. And the hot dog vendor, his truck broke down, and he's going to be late getting to the park for that game because he can't get anybody to repair his truck. And what else? I mean, those would just be three of them, and there'd be eight more. I would scoop them all up, gather them all up. Go out to Mr. Littlejohn's office. He ran a trucking company and an oil distribution company. That was his real work. But I would gather my baseball problems up and go out to his office. And when he heard about these problems, I got the sense he was really happy. And he would say this. He said, now that situation with the Phillies in Philadelphia where they moved a player, oh, that's going to give you a wonderful chance to sell yourself to the farm director. You know, how you handle that. And this situation over here, that banker downtown who won't buy a wall sign, I think this is a great chance for you to sell yourself to him. And, oh, he loved problems. Now, he didn't seek them out, didn't suggest that we create them. But every problem, his position was, listen, anybody can lead in the good times. But when the problems hit, we're going to find out what kind of a leader you are. And through that, you get to sell yourself repeatedly to these different people. Interesting slant on problems, isn't it? And I was thinking this morning, who are the presidents of the United States that we most admire, who have the most number of books pouring out about them? Well, I think it was the presidents who led in periods of conflict and strife and war and tough times, right? I mean, every single month there's another Franklin Delano Roosevelt book coming out. There were more George Washington books and Abraham Lincoln books. I just am blown away. Every month there's a couple more. Out they come. And Harry Truman gets his share. But it was the presidents leading in the toughest times with the most problems that seemed to attract the most attention and get the highest ratings. So don't run from your problems. Principle number five. And here is principle number six. Pay attention to the little things and take care of them. I mentioned that Mr. Littlejohn was in the tanker trailer business. And if ever there was a need to look after the little things, oh boy, that would be the business. The biggest concern that his company had were breakdowns of those oil trucks along the side of the road, or perhaps overturned in a ditch because some mechanic failed to tighten a little bolt on a wheel, just tighten it one more turn, or those kinds of little things could end up costing, you know, thousands of dollars and failed deliveries. Oh, it'd be a nightmare. And generally, it was some little thing that got bungled or was not taken care of. So Mr. Littlejohn was constantly talking about little things. Get on them. Get them done. Take care of them. So let me jump ahead many years. John Wooden, the great coach at UCLA, lived till 99. I wrote him one time when he was in his late 80s, he asked me for permission to write a book about him, and he gave me permission, and through that I got to see him and spend time. I ended up writing two more books about him. Very kind, very gracious, very generous with his time. So through that period, whenever we were in LA, we would call and ask if he was available for dinner, pick him up about 5 o'clock, and head to the Valley Inn, his favorite eating place. So we were there one night, and I was sitting next to him as he ate his clam chowder. Did I tell you about that? Oh, he would take both kinds of clam chowder and have them mixed together. New England and Manhattan mixed together. And it's darn good. Have you ever tried that?
No, but it sounds
give it a shot. But he learned to do that. Oh my, that was kind of a tasty little dish. So I leaned over and I said, Coach, you've been on this earth 90 years. Could you share with me, perhaps, one secret of success that has guided you? And Coach Wooden thought, and then he said to me, the closest I could come, that's how we talked, the closest I could come to one secret of success would be a lot of little things done well. I ended up writing a book about that, a statement he made. The closest I could come to one secret of success would be a lot of little things done well. It made me think of Mr. Littlejohn, you know, in his outlook. And then I thought, boy, I've been doubly blessed, because Mr. Littlejohn and Coach Wooden really were two peas from the same pod. Godly men, successful, loved the Lord, and had this quality called wisdom, and were willing to share it so openly with those who asked. Lord, we come to you this morning grateful for godly men and godly women who just have the ability to look through cloudy situations or confusing circumstances and give us insights, give us clarity about what to do, what you would like done. We're so grateful for those kind of people. And our prayer this morning is help provide us with those tools. Help us be the kind of people that others come to when they have a difficult or confusing situation. Help us be those magnets where people want to come and take from us, because we have developed wisdom and we're not afraid to ask God for it. So that's our prayer here this morning, Lord. Help Dwight have a good morning in Atlanta and return him safely. We pray for our country, Lord. We pray for these candidates, and above all, Lord, would you provide them with wisdom, godly wisdom, because many of them need it. And just be generous as you always are, but more importantly, help them to ask you for wisdom as they move forward. Help it be a good week ahead, Lord. We're grateful for this wonderful weather, and we're thrilled to be living in Orlando, Florida. What a gift that is. So with that, we say thanks, and remember to always give Jesus the credit. And we pray in his name, amen.
Hi, Dwight Bain here, and I want to tell you about calmclass.com. The website that you came to is actually a teaching lesson that we record in Orlando, Florida, every single week. You can actually come be part of the live audience. If you're in Florida, maybe you're visiting the Orlando area, come check us out. We meet at 3000 South John Young Parkway. It's on the campus of First Baptist Orlando, which is actually a pretty large place. So what you're looking for is a large building by a lake. It's a big three-story building called Faith Hall. And we're in Faith Hall, upstairs in room 301. But if you don't get a chance to come live to the presentation in Orlando, then if these lessons about making your life work better, to get past frustration in relationships, maybe frustrations on the job, maybe you're just kind of feeling beat up about what you believe. If you enjoy these lessons, would you do me a favor? Would you tell a friend? Because by your experience of telling other people, hey, this website helped me, these lessons helped me, when you're doing that, you're helping take the message that we teach in Orlando and to be able to spread that to the entire world. And thanks.